What's the use in you denying it? Then what you have is wrong. I heard him promise you forever, but forever's come and gone. Baby, he would say whatever it takes to keep you alive, to the truth between.
Hey guys, good evening. Welcome once again on this third worldwide CME activity on ESW. Topic for today's presentation is biometry and IOL power calculation. To enlighten us on this topic, today we have a person who is authority on IOL power calculation from India. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome this noble, humble, who is down-to-earth personality, a spine of the group and a good human being, the Thalaiwa, the king from Chennai. Please welcome Dr. Ramesh Dorairajan.
My friends, it's a great pleasure for me to be here today to talk on biometry and intraocular lens selection for our group today. Any talk on biometry should always start with a picture of Dr. Warren Hill, a great genius and a person who learned Sanskrit in his later age, only to be able to read the Bhagavad Gita in the original language. To the right, we have a photograph of Jack Halliday, who gave us the Halliday 1 and 2 formulas. And to the right, we have Wolfgang Haggis drinking a cup of tea. Haggis is a remarkable gentleman, the only non-ophthalmologist of this group, a mathematician by profession who got interested in biometry and discovered the Haggis formula. We should also here remember Graham Barrett of Australia. Graham Barrett, Haggis and Warren Hill have generously donated hours and years of their life teaching and improving biometry and giving it to us free of cost to the entire world and making it available online for us. We all know that there are various situations, patient-related and eye-related, which make it very difficult for us to get a proper biometric reading. For the major part of today's talk, I will concentrate on ultrasound biometry and manual keratometry because I believe that the majority of the doctors in India are treating our billion plus population using these two parameters. Optical biometry, I believe, has still not penetrated our community in a large way. To take a proper keratometric reading, please remember keratometry before applying any drop on the cornea. Keratometry should be done before applying paracaine eye drops. Once a month, please do a zero error adjustment and also do a calibration check on your instrument. All of it should start noting down characterometric readings by using decimals and not 0.25 steps. Here we see a picture of a characterometer, and you can see the red line is slightly above the 45 diopter mark. Usually we will note this down as 45, but to become more accurate, although we realize it is not close to the quarter mark, it's not close to 45.25, we have to note this down as 45.1. These small steps will make our biometry. Once a month, we have to check the calibration of our characterometer. At the back of the occluder of the characterometer, we have a small disc. It has got a concave curvature on the posterior surface, and above it is marked 7.5, which is the radius of curvature of this particular disc. So when we measure this disc, our care meter should read 7.5 mm. The picture to the right shows how the IP0 error has to be corrected. When we correct the zero error properly, the crosswire will be seen as a sharp and thin cross. Otherwise, it will look fuzzy. If it is not focused properly, we will get a wrong K reading. The black crosswire should be positioned in the center of the lower right-hand circle when we are measuring the cornea. When it's in the center of the lower right circle, we have aligned the instrument to the corneal vertex. The red arrow shows how the plus marks are not yet aligned properly. Above that, the minus marks are both aligned correctly. This picture shows the calibration disc which comes with every ultrasound A-scan machine, and once in 2 months we should make sure the accuracy of our probe is correct. So we have to go into the calibration mode of the A-scan and we have to measure this disc, and it will show what the reading is. While measuring the axial length by ultrasound, there are 5 types of errors. We all know about this. The most important error is variable corneal compression. The others are a broad beam. The macula may not be located accurately. We may not be measuring the refractive axial length. We may be just measuring some axial length. We make incorrect assumptions regarding the sound velocity, and this may be of importance in very small lenses and very large lenses, and also limited resolution because we're using a 10 megahertz probe. This picture shows the broad beam of sound coming and touching the macula. As you can see, it is reflected both by the humps as well as by the depth of the fovea. The difference can often be close to 0.1 mm and can vary from one patient to the other. When we use an optical biometer, this particular problem is avoided because we are measuring the exact refractive axis. We can also have errors if we set the gain too high or too low. If the gain of the ultrasound machine is set very high, we can get a false short reading and a post-op myopic surprise. While if you keep it very low, we can get a longer eye than normal and a post-operative hyperopic surprise. Let us see now what all we can learn when we see the actual A-scan pattern in the review pane of the machine. When you look at this particular machine, if you look above the 25 millimeter mark, you can see that the scleral spike and the retinal spike have both got fused. So when you have one solid spike which encompasses both the retina as well as the scleral reflection, it means that your gain is very high. So if you see this kind of a solid spike, please lower the gain till you see 2 individual retinal spike and an individual scleral spike arising from the baseline. Within the yellow circle, we have 2 letters. To the left, we have the AC. The AC denotes the anterior chamber depth. And to the right, we have the axial length. Below the AC, we have the various anterior chamber depth. And how do we identify variable corneal compression? By seeing variable anterior chamber depth. Obviously, the anterior chamber, this may be the most important part of this talk today. Please take your ultrasound biometry by making the patient lie down flat and looking up. You can use a wire speculum if needed to keep the eyes open and hold the probe by the wire and not by the shaft. By taking these precautions, you will be making the least amount of corneal indentation while taking the measurement. Corneal compression is seen very clearly in these two measurements. The one above shows 4.29 millimeter anterior chamber depth, while the one below shows 4.00 anterior chamber depth. To the right hand side, we can see that the difference between the above and the below, upper and the lower axial length is exactly 0.3 mm. So the vitreous length is measured correctly, but the anterior chamber depth is 0.3 millimeter compressed in the second reading, and the entire axial length reading becomes 0.3 millimeters less in the second reading. This is a biometrics machine, and here it gives LT, or the lens thickness. To see whether the lens thickness is correct, please look at the quality of the lens thickness spikes. They both should be high and they should be of even height. If one lens thickness spike is high and the other one is low, it means that the ultrasound beam is not hitting the lens surface perpendicularly along the visual axis, but it's hitting it in a slightly oblique fashion. This is another example of a wrong reading where you have steps or ridges in the retinal spike. A good retinal spike should be a straight line without any steps, and it should rise perpendicularly at 90 degrees from the baseline. This is an example of an ultrasound measurement where we are measuring from the cornea to the optic nerve, because there is no scleral spike and there is no orbital fat spike in this particular scan. A good A scan reading should show orbital fat spikes. These are small spikes which decrease progressively behind the scleral spike. If the orbital fat is not seen, it means that we are measuring the cornea to the optic nerve distance and not the cornea to the retina distance. If we place too much water or contact fluid or paracaine on the cornea, we can get this kind of a false anterior chamber depth. Look at 1.84. This 1.84 is caused by a thick droplet of fluid which is forming a coupling fluid between the probe and the cornea, and this is measured as a false anterior chamber. So very shallow anterior chambers can be caused because of excess fluid, and they should be discarded. My friends, I would very much encourage all of you to convert into immersion biometry from tomorrow, from coming Monday. We should stop using contact ultrasound and go in for immersion ultrasound. Properly done, immersion ultrasound will prevent variable corneal compression. It will remove the most important problem with ultrasound biometry, help you to get better results. Although the other four types of errors are present with the immersion method, the magnitude of these errors are much, much less when compared to variable corneal compression. To do an immersion biometry, you need to have a shell. The most commonly available one is a Prager shell, but less expensive, very simple models will work equally well. Your ultrasound machine should also be having the capability to do immersion ultrasound, because it has to ignore the few millimeters of separation between the surface of the probe and the surface of the cornea. Otherwise, it will show a wrong, false, long anterior length. This is the beauty of doing an immersion A scan. This is a printout of one of my patients taken several years ago. See how amazingly equal. There is no variability from one scan to the next. They are all showing the same measurement. 23.48, 23.48, 23.48, 23.49, 23.48. The standard deviation of this long list is just 0.01. It is impossible to get this kind of accurate measurements by contact method. Immersion is far superior to contact biometry. Now that we have seen some of the problems and how to do a better quality axial length measurement and keratometry. We will also see this is a list of all the problems that we can have and the reasons why we can get a erroneously long or a short axial length measurement. But having taken the measurement, we should use the appropriate formula. So in this section, we will discuss the various formula that we have and when to use what formula. We know that there are various generations of formula and most of us are using SRK2 formula, I think, currently. Although we have better formula like Holiday 1, Hoffer Q and SRKT and also Hagen. This is the original paper published in 1988 where the SRK2 formula was described. And this is the original paper in 1991 when the SRKT formula was described.